we know at the 5 year
project. So first of all, I'd like to thank the Org Mailer for giving me a chance to present my work on the California. So this is the title is Insights from Anomalies, Heavy Electron Emergence and Condensation. So most of the work has been done with the support of FM and in collaboration with the Rich Not Fear. So David Pines, Zachary Nipuro, and also the Joe Thompson, Hanno Lee, Ricardo Urbano, and Christine Batista in Los Alamos. So I will give a brief introduction to heavy electron physics, and then I will discuss the anomalous properties of these materials and show you that there's a heavy electron emergence with universal behavior. Then I will discuss the relation between these heavy electrons and superconductivity. I will suggest a new phase diagram and possibly point to new macroscopic descriptions. So the heavy electron superconductivity was first activation of superconductivity. It was first found in 1979 in serum copper to silicon II. And decades of research actually shows very rich ground state that we have this P-wave superconductor serum cobalt indium wire and the P-wave in PD3, and we have antiferro magnets in cerium rhodium indium wire, due to zinc 17, ytterbium rhodium silicon II, and we have ferromagnet, non-magnetic, and the combo insulator, and especially we have a hot heating order like in uranium and silicon. And the new family of fermion materials is found in 2001 in cerium, that's the cerium 105 material. And in cerium cobalt indium wire, we have the highest superconducting transition temperature, about 2.3 Kelvin, is all cerium heavy fermion materials. And this is, you already see this diagram, this figure, which is specific at the function of temperature. You see a very sharp transition here. When you apply a magnetic field, the specific goes to 1 joule per mole Kelvin square, which is 100 times larger than what you see in your normal metal. That's why it's called heavy. So the first theoretical study of this probably is in 1977 by Doniak. If we take this cerium 105 as an example, this is a structure. The cerium ion here form a lattice with 1 f electron per cerium. And it has f orbitals splitted into a ground state doublet and excited crystal field level. So these f electrons hybridize with natural electrons, so you get a counter coupling and the induced artificial coupling between the cerium ions. This is called combo lattice model. So the competition between these two couplings, the counter coupling and artificial coupling, leads to the well-known Doniak phase diagram. When the coupling is small, artificial coupling dominates, so it's thought to have an antiferromagnetic ground state. When the coupling is large, the counter effect dominates, you get formulated. This picture has been a qualitative picture for decades. We still don't know exactly for each material how much, the exact value of these quantities. And another progress is, another thing is that around the quantum critical point, we find a superconducting dome. And what's most interesting is, in this region here, you actually have a coexistence of antiferromagnetism and superconductivity. So the question here I want to ask is, how can we estimate these parameters? That will give a good check to the theory. And then, how is a quantum critical point here related to the superconductivity, which is also an interesting question in high keys. The difficulty is we don't have a solution to the quantum lattice model. And there's crystal field effect here. So I think it's important to find some universal and fundamental properties that may be used to verify different theoretical ideas without going to the detail of like a calculation involving the crystal field effect, etc. So this goes to the anomalous properties of heavy electron material. Maybe one of the most interesting is the net shape anomaly. Here, you measure the net shape of the nuclear spin coupled to the surrounding spins. This is the next shift of serum cobalt indium 5 on different set, a cobalt and indium set as a function of temperature. And this is the plot stability. What we see is above a certain temperature, the net shift is always proportional to the stability. But below that, all the net shift measured on different nuclear sets deviate from the stability. So what is more interesting is probably this data set. At high temperature, it's constant, and below about same temperature, it becomes temperature dependent. So interestingly, this is at about 50 Kelvin. And you also see simultaneously in the resistivity and the stability data, a kink here in the stability and a peak in the resistivity. And in the Hall anomalous, Hall coefficient data, you also see a similar behavior at a similar temperature. And if I go further, you can see the Raman spectra at same temperature, and you have a quantum contact spectroscopy, which has a symmetry, and it develops at similar temperature, especially the optical conductivity. Below about 50 Kelvin, you start to have a so-called capitalization gap. So this seems to suggest that this temperature is actually a property of the system, which we should, is not simply a coincidence. In fact, we check for many materials a different property, and probably for other materials it's not so clear as serum cobalt indium 5, but we see a roughly similar temperature, some anomalous property happens. And then, to understand what this temperature is, we dilute the system, just as you heard from Sidon. So you get a single ion condo temperature from this compound, and you can estimate condo cupping. What we find is this G-star actually have a G-square behavior, which is a typical form for RP-pure interaction. So this is a plot for different materials, and this blue line is for serum rhodium indium 5 under pressure. So this seems to suggest that G-star is given by the RP-pure interaction. So that's a very interesting point, because previous theory actually saw G-star is some kind of lattice condo temperature. In that scenario, if my understanding is correct, you actually have F spins, which was first screened by conducting electron and then form a band. However, this indicates that infrared should be surprised already at temperature far above G-star. What we really find experimentally for the entropy of serum cobalt indium 5 is it goes along to a value for the ground state doublet at about 50 Kelvin. I mean, if you look at another example like serum rhodium indium 5, you find at 20 Kelvin there is anomalous enhancement of Hall coefficient, and at the same time you see the entropy goes to about allowed to at 20 Kelvin, around 20 Kelvin. So this appears to me exclude the such a scenario based on lattice condo effect. And on the other hand, it's reasonable because we know there's a competition between the RP-pure coupling and the condo effect. So the true condo temperature in the lattice is surprised. In some theory, it's zero at quantum critical point. If we think this material are close to the quantum critical point, let's say the high temperature sphere, whatever it is, it cannot be a condo temperature. There should be no place for so-called bare condo temperature as a boundary for anything. So on the other hand, an RP-pure type of correlation can really reduce the impurity spectrum. If a resistive peak, it can also suppress magnetic stability. So if I plot the T-star, the so-called RP-pure coupling on new phase diagram, we see that we have this serum copper 6, which is believed to close to quantum critical point, and serum cobalt indium 5 around the assembly point. This line will be a single ion condo temperature. It does not intersect as predicted by Donian Fisdell. There are, of course, two possibilities. One possibility is the true condo temperature in the lattice may be enhanced somewhat so that it may intersect here. But another one, as I proposed, it may be just because the true condo temperature is surprised to here, and the any temperature scale appeared explicitly in the physical property at high temperature. should be the object UI instead of anything like Kano. So the interpretation is what happens below the temperature T star. It was actually have a natural explanation from so-called two-fluid model first proposed by Satoru Natsuki, Natsuki and David Pines for specific and stability analysis. And later it came by Nifuro to the net shape. So in this model, we think at high temperature, we only have a local movement so that the stability and the net shape are very the same thing. This is this quantity. However, below, when you have a heavy fluid emerging because of hybridization, you get a second component, which is the heavy fluid. We name it as a Kano liquid. It has a different hydrogen coupling for the net shape. Therefore, you can define easily a net shape anomaly, which is proportional to the emerging heavy fluid. We actually have some prediction of universal formula. And the interesting thing is for this one, it's a constant high temperature, so it suggests that this B is zero. That's the coupling to the local moment Tc is zero. So they direct, if this model is correct, it directly probe the heavy fluid. And in K, in fact, it does probe the heavy fluid and the, and this curve, as well as many other net shape anomaly in many other materials, does follow the formula we propose. And the same formula, there's originally theory explained this net shape anomaly by a crystal field effect, but crystal field effect can't give such a universal behavior. And the similar behavior is found in the conducting symmetry. And if you plot the Hall anomaly as a function of temperature, you also see it fade for different pressure and for different location. So then come back to the phase diagram, we have alkyl coupling, and below we have a Kano liquid emergence, which is has a universal behavior, and we think that's probably some kind of Newtonian state matter. And of course, if the original theory is correct, there should be a Kano screening at very low temperature. This is supposed to be some quantum critical point. And another interesting thing is that around this quantum critical point, we have a superconductivity and a coexistence of antiferromagnetism. This is an experimental phase diagram for cerium rhodium indium phosphide. So since the Kano liquid exists in such a large temperature range, so it's natural to ask what's the relation between Kano liquid and the superconductivity. To do that, we extend our analysis of net shape anomaly. Net shape anomaly and to the superconducting state. So what is interesting is you see there is an intersection between these two net shape data and at the same time this net shape data go to zero. So it's slightly different temperature because it's married on different magnetic fields, so the Tc is slightly different. So previously, this change, temperature dependence and net shift is explained by, was explained by the temperature dependence of hydrogen coupling. But of course, if there is some kind of coincidence, it cannot be due to this changing net shift, changing hydrogen coupling with temperature. So, but in the two-fluid model, if we think, take this curve, which has no net shape anomaly and stability, we can still subtract net shape anomaly. We see besides this change of Tc due to magnetic field, we actually also get a universal behavior, even in the superconducting phase. So we further analyzed spin lattice relaxation rate, and we found that heavy components have actually have spin lattice relaxation formula at proportional T plus T0, which is the quantum critical fluctuation of 2D spin liquid. So therefore, it's saying that in the Kano liquid, we have a quantum critical fluctuation, and then it comes into a superconducting state. We also did analysis for antiferromagnetism And what we found is possibly get the same array event. This is the preliminary result, so I won't discuss that. So back to the phase diagram, we have a local moment piece at high temperature, and we have various anomalies and entropy error 2 and coherence behavior in the receptor at T-star, which we think is articular, and we have an emerging contour liquid with universal behavior below this temperature. And that contour liquid possibly condenses into a superconductivity and form alpha and ferromagnetic ordering. So this is a new phase diagram we want to suggest. And this line, which is a contour temperature line, may be surprised to a lower contour temperature due to the competition with RTKY and lead to some contour screening at the very low temperature. So we think any series must be able to explain this general property. So there is an important implication of this two-fluid model is it actually changes our standing on quantum critical behavior in physical properties, for example, like resistivity. In the two-fluid model, this is simply due to the reduced contour scattering. So, but originally, this kind of linear behavior, temperature linear behavior, or temperature sublinear behavior, was thought to be a signature for quantum criticality. So the question is, in this two-fluid model, is this accidental, or is also has some fundamental signs? And also left in this, in lattice relaxed rate, this chief quarter, one-fourth behavior is thought to be a quantum critical behavior. However, in our analysis, we actually found a different kind of temporary dependence. So this is something we really need to think about. So anyway, all this lead to a suggestion, lead to a question, what do we mean by contour liquid? We have these properties like resistivity, susceptibility, entropy, net shift, anti-ferromagnetic, point to the correlated schemes with electrical interaction, and then we have optical conductivity and point of contact. RPs and superconductivity seem to suggest attenuating charge. How to combine this together into a contour liquid is a fundamental question we want to answer, but we don't know. So one possibility is if we think about periodic energy model, which describes a heavy electron material in the local region, local lattice region, we get a contour lattice model, and the attenuant region, we get actually an effect TD model, coupled to a residue conducting electron, and every electron has radiation. So if this is weak, so we get effectively a one-man model, which is similar to a high TC, and it has a dominant energy skew given by the exchange current. This, of course, cannot explain all heavy electron physics, but it suggests that maybe in heavy electron material, there are some way to include this hybridization to give attenuating charge and with a dominant coupling due to RKY. So I want to point out that in the probably the single numerical calculation down to like 10 Kelvin by Shim, Christine Holler, and W. Cotelia on cerium iridium minium 5, they find this is the resonance peak for the heavy electrons. And this is the peak cap at the function temperature. Their result actually exactly similar to what we find. And with a similar temperature, T star at about 30 Kelvin. So in some sense, this calculation have a similar physics with our prediction. The question is whether it really can explain other properties in our analysis and what this simple DMC calculation without taking into account RTKY explicitly indicate about the nature of the RTKY interaction in the system. So I leave two questions here. One is that we want to find a macroscopic description of emerging contour liquid heavy fluid. Another is we want to understand the connection between this emerging contour liquid and the low temperature phase, the superconductivity and antiferromagnetics. So just to summarize, I show the existence of characteristic temperature T star for a variety of heavy electron anomalies, and this T star has RTKY form. And then I show that below T star there's a heavy fluid combo liquid emergence. It has a universal spilling behavior. And in this combo liquid, there's a probably a common critical fluctuation at low temperature, and then it condensed into a superconducting state. Then the last one is whether we can get a macroscopic realization of a heavy electron state. And these are the reference. Thank you for attention.
I have from time to time asked the DMFT theorists if they know how to decompose within the framework of their calculation the system into two fluids. And so far I think the answer has been no. And I'm curious whether the status of that might have changed.
So, I mean, probably I shouldn't need to answer this question since I'm not doing DMFT, but yes, actually, one way to think about the decomposition, I remember some people, they decompose a DM, how to say, the electron band, electron state, that into two pieces. One piece, you have the heavy particles close to the temporal potential, home energy, which is the particle band. Another is the huge carbon peak. But it's not clear to me whether the science of composition has anything to do with this equalization. Maybe there's something.
Well, I think the important thing is that the real Fermi nucleus in dot gap is never reached. Okay, if you really want to see pure T square behavior, you have to go below 5 degree Kelvin or even lower than that. So what the DMFT is doing is describing this incoherent regime where the quasi particles are not yet full fledged formed, and there are some interesting universalities in there, and we can compute various spectroscopic signatures. So the reason why there's not a simple description is because we're providing a handle on a regime which is not Fermi-Leucid-like. So I would say the simplest thing that describes that is this impurity model in a self-consistent medium which has not reached the Fermi-Leucid fixed point. Now, probably there should be some other description in terms of some other intermediate fixed points, but nobody has found that yet.
That's a question. Well, I have a question. You've done a lot of collating of experimental data, but presumably, if the entropy starts to quench the scale of order J squared, you should be able to see it in perturbation theory in such a model. Any model to be decided. Have you tried to look for any of these phenomena from a theoretical perspective?
So that's actually a good point. So it's true that if it's the physics is like Alexander lag, and that's in some cases it indicates it's not strongly correlated, really strongly correlated, since at least at high temperature. So I have not looked at into that yet, but we know in the magnetic alloy, I think that work. So you also have such a peak in the resistivity. In a magnetic alloy, you also have a peak at this actually a similar behavior for the resistivity. But I don't know whether the entropy actually surprised at the same temperature or not. So this seems to suggest that it's quite similar to the magnetic alloy, but on the other hand, you also have this this optical conductivity signature, which is not. So that's the difficulty how to link this kind of charge behavior with this thing for us.
Thank you very much. Well, thanks. Before we break for lunch, Zachary Fisk was going to lead a discussion on some of these topics.